think there's some maps.
Yeah. Thank you, and thank you for the invitation. It's great to see that in-person conferences are going back alive. Yeah, and I'm sorry that I couldn't come in person, but it is still nice to be back in Biedlivo, at least virtually. So let me start my talk with the following example. So I hope it's an easy example and in some sense well-known. So let us consider an annulus, like a closed annulus. And let us consider a 2-to-1 self-covering of this annulus onto itself. Well, then the claim is that there is a semi-conjugacy from this self-covering map towards the standard Dublin map of the unit circle. Well, and the reason, like one of the reason, is that we can easily apply the pullback argument. So we can just first choose any continuous map, H naught from the annulus onto the unit circle. Well, this continuous map should induce the isomorphism of the fundamental groups. And I ignore base points. Usually, when we are talking about the push forward on the level of the fundamental group, we wanted to respect the base point, but it's not that serious. Well, and now this continuous map can be lifted through F and Z square. So we can construct H1, which would be the lift of H0, and H1 will still be a continuous map from A towards the unit circle, and so on. But like now, because of the expansion of Z square, the sequence of continuous map Hn converge exponentially fast to a limiting map H. Well, this is because if you look at the homotopical distance between Hn and its lift, then it should decrease exponentially fast. So in this way, we obtain a semi-conjugacy. In fact, it will be unique in this example from the self-covering map of the annulus towards the standard Dublin map. And I'd like first to stress that the only important condition here is that the original map should respect the fundamental groups. So this is in some sense phi one condition. And another important ingredient is the expansion of Z square. Well, and then we can slightly modify this example, perhaps make it a bit more complicated if we want. For example, we can easily replace an annulus by a solid torus. And again, we can consider a self-covering of this solid torus. And same argument would give us a semi-conjugacy from the self-covering map onto the unit circle. Or we can consider a partial self-covering. So instead of a proper covering map, we can consider a sum sub-annulus inside A naught and consider a covering map from this sub-annulus A1 onto A naught. Well, and again, there will be more or less the same conclusion. So except that the semi-conjugacy will not be on the whole annulus, but it will be on the non-escaping set of the annulus. Namely, we can introduce An as the nth lift of A naught, take the intersection of all the An. So this will give us the non-escaping set. Well, and then same pullback argument is applicable, and we obtain a semi-conjugacy. Again, the expansion of the square is important. Or if we want, we can add some handles to our annulus. So in A1, in A0, we can add this handle. So the fundamental group will not be Z anymore. Then when we take a pre-image under a covering map, we would have to add two handles to A1. But still, more or less the same procedure with necessary adjustments work. Well, for example, well, instead of, well, let me say how to adjust this condition. So instead of considering the full fundamental group of A0, we can consider the quotient of the fundamental group of A0 under the loops that don't matter. For example, under this type of loops. So this will be all loops, so that F minus N of gamma consists of 2 to the power N loops. So loops don't open up under taking a pre-image. So this is what Volodya calls an iterated monodromy group of F. Well, now this will be isomorphic to the group of integers. Well, it's now the original H naught would have to respect this IMG. So it should induce the isomorphism between integer groups. And again, same argument works. Well, another remark that I wanted to make is that if we start with an expanding map G of the circle and try to, and if we have another expanding map of the circle F, well, then if we apply such procedure, then this would give us a conjugacy. So this is let me call a principle. That if we have two maps that are combinatorially equivalent, for example, homotopic, and if FG are expanding, then they must be conjugate, or they should be conjugate, because we also need to put some perhaps natural conditions. Well, and the reason is that in this pullback argument, we can apply this pullback argument for Hn and for the inverses of Hn, and conclude that both H and H minus one exist. And they would give us a conjugacy. Well, in this combinatorial equivalence, if we want, we can state it in terms of the fundamental group. So this would generalize a bit the notion of homotopy equivalence. Well, I don't want to go into details of how it's done, but just as a remark that this dynamical system, well, the circle namely, can be reconstructed from just knowing what it does on the level of the fundamental group. So from its push forward on the level of the fundamental group, which is just n goes to 2 times n. So just knowing this and just knowing that our map is expanding, we can conclude that it's Julia set, or its non-escaping set should be a circle together with a Dublin map. Okay, so that was a few examples about one-dimensional expansion dynamics. So let me switch to posthetically finite rational maps. So let me recall that a rational map is posthetically finite is if the orbit of critical points of F is finite. And I'm going to use these notations. So this notation means that A contains its forward image plus the image of the critical points. Well, there are many examples of posthetically finite rational maps, like the Basilica, Chebyshev polynomial, Z square, well, rabbit, airplane. And what's important with every such example is that they are all expanding maps. So, for example, well, let us consider the Basilica. So this is the field in Julia set of the Basilica. Well, and we can view this map as a correspondence, a partial self-covering correspondence. So we remove on the target the post-critical set. In the thought, we remove the pre-image of the post-critical set. So one of the maps will be a covering. So namely the F itself. Well, then another map will be an inclusion. Well, it's now the covering map respects the hyperbolic metric. So it is an isometry with respect to the hyperbolic metric, and inclusion is contracts the hyperbolic metric. So this is how we introduce a metric that is expanded by a post-critically finite rational map. So the only thing that we need to know is that the post-critical set is finite. So geometrically, with respect to the hyperbolic metric, the basilica would look something like this. So there will be the infinity, there will be a cusp. So there will be two more cusps corresponding to minus one and zero. So these three points are removed. So this is a sphere. And the interesting dynamics of the basilica, namely the Julia set, is a compact subset of the sphere. And the map is uniformly expanding in the neighborhood of the Julia set. So let me introduce the following notion. So let us call a topological map of the sphere Bercher expanding if F expands some Riemannian abifold metric of the sphere. And the second condition is the normalization that around periodic critical points, we would like that the first return map is conjugate to the standard covering map. So this is a normalization Bercher condition. Here we postulate the expansion property of a post-critically finite rational map. And this is a generalization of PCF rational maps. So I believe this notion was first introduced by Kamayama. I mean, he also did look at the Julia sets of such expanding maps. So they can be defined in a similar way as the Julia sets of PCF rational maps. For example, as the closure of repellent periodic points. And he also showed how to do a symbolic presentation of such Julia sets out of what is happening on the fundamental group. Well, Volodya's theory of iterated monodromy groups is also applicable. So he wrote a book in 2005, but the theory has been developed a bit earlier. Well, expanding maps were also studied by Peter Kosinski and Kevin Pilgrim on one hand, and on the other hand by Mario Bonk and Daniel Meyer. But they were considering only the case when the Julia set is the whole sphere. So they were more motivated by the Cannon conjecture. Well, one fact about such expanding maps is that together with Laran, we show that a topological map of a sphere, a Thurston map, is isotopic to an expanding map if and only if F has no Levy abstraction. So an abstraction for being equivalent to a rational map is more complicated. So it is an abstraction of the Grotius inequality. So a topological Thurston map is equivalent to a rational map if and only if it does not violate the Grotius inequality around a multicurve. But in the case of expanding maps, the abstraction is easier. So it is what's known as Levy abstraction. Well, and the definition is that gamma is a Levy curve. So Levy curve. And we can assume that it's simple periodic. Well, if it can be mapped forward with degree one to f of gamma, okay, fn of gamma, such that fn of gamma is isotopic to the original gamma. So it's more natural to state this condition using the pre-image than taking the forward iteration. So that's a definition of a Levy cycle. So as a topic should mean real, the postcritical set, so real A. Well, and it is an abstraction to the expansion because the minimal length of a representative of gamma up to homotopy . So if we look at all curves gamma prime that are homotopic to gamma real A, then clearly if we assume that there is an expanding metric, then the length must be zero. So as an example of a Levy abstraction, well, we can take z goes to z square. So this will be zero here somewhere is infinity. And let us also mark one. So this will be the map from C hat infinity 0, 1 to itself. Well, now we can isotope this map and introduce one more fixed point around one, so slightly isotope. So this will be another fixed point somewhere here. But now the cycle, the simple closed curve that surrounds these two fixed points, well, is a Levy abstraction. So this map cannot be equivalent to an expanding map. So we obtain a map F. So F will be from the, well, now a topological sphere, 0, infinity, 1, and x. Well, and our result with Laurent states that a Levy cycle is the only abstraction to be in an expanding map. And a brief idea of the proof is that if we have a Levy free map F, then we can decompose canonically into post-critically finite rational maps. So this will be PCF rational map. Well, and post-critically finite rational map are expanding. So on this small sphere, we have an expanding metric. Well, and then we can also see that because it's Levy free, then the decomposition itself could be kind of combinatorially expanding. So it's then and then expanding hyperbolic matrix from periodic small spheres can be glued together and provide a global expanding metric. So in this construction, we are using the Thurston realization theorem. And here, kind of one remark is that, well, I don't know, and I'm not aware that, I'm not aware of other ways how to introduce an expanding metric of, on a two-dimensional object. So it seems difficult to prove this theorem directly without using Thurston theorem, because two-dimensional objects, well, they are in a way tricky and unclear how to introduce the expanding metric on them. But on one-dimensional objects, we can introduce an expansion. And the decompositions, well, they will have be they will be roughly one dimensional. Okay, so this is what I wanted to say about expanding maps, but I will discuss also some application to the mating problem. Let me just briefly say that with this notion, we kind of have a classification, the following classification of geometric Thurston maps. So first of all, if we have any branch covering of a sphere, then there are two possibilities, either it's degree one or bigger degree of or in non-invertible. So in degree one, we have finite order and pseudo-Anosov maps that are kind of geometric. Well, in degree greater than one, essentially all Levy-free maps are geometric. So they contain rational examples. So rational maps are examples of expanding maps, but then there are also exceptional hyperbolic maps coming from the Lattice example, when one direction is repelling, another direction is attracting. So for example, we can take this matrix. So it induces a map on the torus, where one direction is expanded Another is contracting. Well, and then if we quotient it by minus identity, then we obtain a map on the sphere. Well, and this sphere map will not be expanded, but it will still be geometric in this sense. Well, and in fact, the expanding direction will dominate contracting direction, and this is quite handy for certain arguments. So this, well, such objects were classified by Nikita and Schmeichel and Polsky. Okay, so let me now switch to matings. So here there are two polynomials, the rabbit and basilica. And the mating is an operation that produces, or at least tries to produce, a rational map out of two polynomials. So suppose one polynomial is on the upper semisphere, the second polynomial is on the lower hemisphere. So here we have a circle at infinity. So on the infinity, the map would be just a covering self-map. So we assume that they have the same degree, and then they are monic. And then the formal mating well, it's a map obtained from these two polynomials, so that one polynomial acts on one hemisphere, another acts on the second hemisphere, and here is a covering map. So this is a sphere. So a formal mating is always well defined. Well, but there is another more geometric mating, which is sometimes called a topological mating. So when we take our formal mating, let me call it like this. So the topological mating is obtained by collapsing all rays in our sphere. Well, and the reason why we might want to consider a topological mating is because topological matings often give a precise topological model for rational maps. up to conjugacy. So this is a theorem by Mary Rees and Tan Lei that if we are considering any two hyperbolic polynomials in the Mandelbrot set, let's assume that they are post-critically finite, then they are mutable if and only if they are not in conjugate primary limbs of the Mandelbrot set. So much more precisely, the following are equivalent. So either the formal mating is unobstructed. In this case, it is equivalent to the rational map. Or the topological mating is a sphere map, namely this construction when we collapse all rays. Well, closures of every ray gives a nice topological true sphere. Or the last condition is that the polynomials are not in conjugate primary limbs. Well, and what I wanted to say is that the proof really goes in the following directions. That if we assume that our formal mating is unobstructed, then we can apply the Thurston theorem and construct our rational map. So this is the Thurston theorem. Well, let's now more or less by this reason, using the pullback argument, for example, we can obtain a semi-conjugacy from our formal mating into this rational map. So applying the pullback argument would collapse the annulus between these two fields in Julia sets. And then doing a little bit of symbolic dynamics, we can justify that this rational map is in fact conjugate to the topological mating. So in particular, the topological mating is on a sphere. So the topological mating is a sphere map. Well, and then having a topological sphere map as a topological mating, we can see that there are no Lewis cycles. Well, and then the circle can be completed. So in degree two, every abstraction is Lewy. And I'm not aware of any other logics that switches some of the steps. So it seems that difficult or maybe close to impossible to analyze the equivalence relation induced by rays. So when we collapse rays, so even though we sort of understand how individual rays land at the Julia set, I mean, it's it seems to be difficult or perhaps impossible to kind of understand this type of diagrams. So one array of the upper polynomial may be related to another array. Well, and then when we go to the lower polynomial, here we may have like two rays landing together, and then we would want to follow another ray back to the upper polynomial. So this ray at the upper polynomial may collend with another ray, and so on. Yeah, and this combinatorial picture seems to be difficult to analyze directly. But instead, the argument is somewhat indirect. First construct a model and then show that the topological matching is our model. Okay, so this is the case of quadratic polynomials. So in degree greater than two, there are more complicated abstractions. Perhaps the simplest example is the Tanley-Shishikura matching examples. So this is an expanding map, but not a rational map. Well, now thanks to our characterization of expanding maps, some bits of this theorem can be generalized to all polynomials in the following fashion. So the following is equivalent. So either two polynomials have a mating that is Levy-free, or the topological mating is a sphere map, or P minus and P plus do not have a pinching cycle of periodic angles. And by a pinching cycle, I mean the following situation. So we have one polynomial upstairs. So we have another polynomial downstairs.
We don't see your writing.
I'm sorry. Sometimes it happens. Right. At which stage did you miss me? Okay. Well. Well, anyways, this is a statement. So we have, and by a pinching cycle, I mean the following configuration. That we can start with a periodic ray of one polynomial, and then we can go to another polynomial, then it may collend with another periodic ray, and so on. And then this way we may obtain a loop formed by periodic rays. So this is what I mean by pinching cycles. Well, and somewhere here would be an equator of the mating. So such loop is necessary, a Levy cycle. So in degree two, if there is such periodic loop, then there would exist a periodic loop that passes through the alpha fixed point. Well, leading to the condition of being in conjugate limbs. So in degree greater than true, this doesn't have to be the case anymore. So there are examples when a loop really has to go through equator multiple times. But again, the argument follows more or less the recipe of quadratic polynomials. So the recipe that if we have a formal matching that is Levy free, then it is equivalent now to an expanding map. We have a semi-conjugacy from the topological matching to the expanding map. So therefore we conclude that our expanding map is the topological matching. And as a conclusion, the topological matching is a sphere map. Well, and then the cycle can be completed. Okay, so I wanted to mention how everything is related to the certain distability problem, but perhaps I'll skip this part. So let me just mention that when we do the Thurston realization theorem, there is an intermediate covering correspondence. So this is like a post-critically finite map in a higher dimension. In general, this is non-uniformly expanding. And if it is expanding, then the Thurston distability is solvable in the polynomial time. So this is the case of the polynomials, for example, twisted rabbit problems. So for the twisted rabbit problem, this correspondence will take this form. But in general, this correspondence is only non-uniformly expanding, and perhaps by understanding how uniform expansion fails at the boundary, there might be a progress towards certain distability, namely towards better algorithms. So let me, in the remaining of the time, discuss abstracted matings. So this is the matching of the airplane and the basilica. So let's imagine that this is a formal matching living somewhere on the sphere. So as I said, this is abstracted. So the formal matching has Levy abstraction. So F, so the basilica formal matched with the airplane is Levy abstracted. The topological matching will not be Hausdorff. So it's not going to be a sphere map, but even more, it's not a Hausdorff. But still, topological matching in this example can be understood. And this not being Hausdorff is not that much of a series. So what happens is that if we collapse rays, plus take the Hausdorff quotient. So if we try to make it Hausdorff, then what we obtain is an expanding coctoid. So the structure of this coctoid would resemble the structure of FATU components. So these two spheres will switch. And then the first return time will be, the first return map will be a Chebyshev polynomial.
So sorry, how's the
Could you repeat the question, Daniel? Could you repeat the question?
Daniel, we don't hear you. And also, I have a suggestion to Dmitry. We should come to some conclusion because our time is, honestly speaking, over.
I'm almost done. Right.
Okay. And the question from Daniel, maybe there will come some time for question after you finish your talk.
Right. Yeah. So as I said, the quotient would look like this. So it will be a coctoid structure. Well, and then this airplane points, so they will be in the limit. Well, and then, well, from here to here, we go like 2 to 1, then we go 2 to 1, 1 to 1 here, well, and so on. So what I'm claiming is that this object could be understood, and in particular, the ray equivalence could be understood. And in fact, perhaps a better way of understanding this topological matching is first collapse for two components of the airplane. And then if we collapse the FATU components of the airplane, we obtain what is known as an expanding version of the airplane. But now this expanding version of the airplane has a nice mating with the basilica. So now this object can be mated properly. Well, and the result will be this coctoid. And again, the way how we justify, we first construct this coctoid as an expanding model, and then we show that the topological matching when we do this must be this coctoid. So same logic as in the matching theorem of Mary-Ree-Stanley for quadratic polynomials. And this is again a general recipe, and it's part of our work with Laran and Kevin. So we call such objects relatively expanding. So relatively expanding means that upstairs we have a partial self-covering, and downstairs we have an expanding continuous map. And then we can do again the group theory and a bit of geometry, and in particular, the Julia set here might be symbolically encoded. So let me stop here. Jan, thank you.
Thank you very much for interesting talk. Are there any questions? Maybe Daniel?
Okay, can you guys hear me now? Or?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, sorry, I don't know, this is weird setting. I mean, okay, so actually here I just had a very quick question. I mean, so the Hausdorff quotient is again so that you take the closure of the equivalence relation and then you take the quotient with respect to that closure. Is that correct?
Right, yeah.
Okay. Yes.
Okay. So here, the value of the Hausdorff can be easily understood, and there is kind of a natural way how to resolve it, and the only way. So this will be, in one way, we may say that this is sort of the maximal Hausdorff quotient of the topological mating. If you don't collapse for two components of the plane, then each of these points, like A, B, C, should be blown up into a circle.
But when you say Hausdorff quotient, you don't yet have collapsed the two components of the airplane. Is that correct?
Right. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, without collapsing the two components of the airplane.
Yeah. Maybe like a quick comment. So you know, when you, let's say, mate and you, I mean, you know, you have I don't know, polynomials, and you collapse the two components, and you made them, that actually also sort of, I mean, comes up in my unmating type thing. So I mean, so if you have periodic critical points and you know you have these expanding first maps, then you can actually always unmate in exactly this form where you know have these polynomials and you collapse the factor components. Just a quick comment. Okay.
More questions, more comments from those who are present at the lecture room, from the others. Okay, if not, let's thank the speaker again. Now we have